Can you?
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Al Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma abad. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa min ahsanu qawlan mimman da'a ila Allahi. Wa amila salihan. Qala innani minal muslimin. Rabbi shrah li sadri. Wayassir li amri. Wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. I welcome all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. We are most welcome to ask any questions on Islam and comparative religion. Any question which a non-Muslim have asked you and you are unable to reply. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum, sir.
Wa alaikum assalam wa barakatuh.
The Jews actually use the system of sabah whenever they halal. It's a kind of this thing, sabah. Are we permitted to eat that food?
The brother asked the question that when the Jews do their kind of zabiha, are we allowed to eat the kind of food? The Quran clearly mentions that, as well as the hadith, they do zabiha, it's called as kosher. And it's clearly mentioned in the Quran in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 5, that lawful for you for food are the food of the people of the book. So food which is halal for them is also halal for us. And if we enter and read the Bible, so that's clearly mentioned the same principles as applied in the Quran, the Sunnah is there. So if they call it as kosher, for Muslims allowed. But that does not mean that if any Ahl-e Kitab, any Christian that serves the food becomes halal. If it's a meat, mutton or non-veg food, served by Ahl-e Kitab, if it's not done zabiya or not kosher, it's haram for us. Now if we analyze that, today the modern Jews, many of the modern Jews, they don't do kosher. So we have to first see to it that it's a kosher meat. So best is zabiya done by Muslim, number one. But if you're going to a foreign land where you can't find zabiya meat done by a Muslim, the second option which is allowed is kosher done by the Jews. But if it's sold by Ahl-e Kitab, Jews and Christians, which is not kosher, then it's haram for us. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
This is a question posed by a child. That as in Surah Fussilat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you repel evil with goodness and your enemy will become your most intimate friend. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the shaitan is an enemy for man. So is it that if you are good to shaitan, he'll become your intimate friend?
Sister asked a question that the Quranic verse says that repel evil with good. And other places in the Quran it says that shaitan is the avowed enemy. Various places, including Surah Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 168, that the avowed enemy to the human beings is the shaitan. So does it mean we have to be good to the shaitan? I say yes. You have to be good to the shaitan. Good means what? You have to dawa to him. Fine. Good means get him on the straight path. See, shaitan is of two types. Allah says in Surah Nas, the last chapter of the Quran, chapter number 114, verse number 126, the last verse it says, Kulaz Rabbin Nas, Malikin Nas, Ilahin Nas, Min Sharril Waswasil Khannas, Allazi Yuwaswisu Fi Sudurin Nas, Minil Jinnati Wan Nas. That amongst the evil people who whisper and withdraw, the category of Satan, amongst them, there are some who are men and some who are jinns. Amongst them, men and jinn. So the seen shaitan, the one you can see, are the human beings, produced by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the seen satans, and the unseen ones are the jinns. And the head is the iblis. And iblis was the jinn. But there are satans in the human beings. So human being who tries to convince you to do something haram, how do you repel? You be good with him. Tell him robbing is wrong, raping is wrong, don't cheat. That's good. He may think it's not good for him, but actually it's good for him. So even when Satan comes, we have to repel evil with good. Good means speak the truth. Allah says in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse number 256, that La ikraha fid deen, there is no compulsion in religion, but truth stands out clear from error. So when the Satan comes also, you repel it with good, don't repel it with evil back. If he's cheating, you don't cheat him. There are parts in the Quran which have given you permission that you can, as Allah says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 126, that if they catch you out, you can catch them out in the same way, but not worse. But best is forgiveness. So there are chances where Allah has given you permission. But the best is repel evil with good. In some cases, you can catch them out same, but cannot do an evil act. That becomes allowed in Islam if they do something wrong to you. You can use that same strategy as long as it's not a haram strategy, but don't go beyond the limits. But the normal general rule is repel evil with good, sister. Even if Satan is there, repel him with good, and inshallah, try and make that Satan a Muslim, inshallah. Hope that answers the question, sister. Any brothers have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Brother, is a sister from the sister's side. She said about sunnah, whether we can, what is a sin and what is not a sin, as you had explained it before. There is one thing like, you know, removing of the beard. When you have already grown a beard, remove it and then you can grow it again. This is a part of this, what I wanted to ask you at that time. And I have a question relating to this thing, sins and all the thing. When a Hindu says that, I believe in Ishwar, the same way as you believe in Allah. But there are many people in the sect like who believe in Dargah. So I'm one of them, part of them. I also believe in Dargah also. I go to the Dargah also. I go to my temple also. What is their concept is that they are having the same thing, the same ideology, like, you know. So how to deal with this kind of people?
Well, there are two questions. The first question is that suppose you keep a beard, and then if I shave off that beard and then keep a beard again, isn't it a sin? So many people think that, you know, one is to grow a beard and then shaving becomes haram. First, you have to realize that is keeping a beard is fard or mustahab. Some scholars say it's a fard because of the commandment of the Prophet. There's no verse in the Quran saying whether the beard should be kept or not. But Allah said, "Ati Rasul, obey Allah and obey the Messenger." It's clearly mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, point number 7, hadith number 788, 781, that the beloved Prophet said, "Let your beards grow and trim your mustaches." So those people are very strict who say that anything what the Prophet has commanded and has not done action contrary to it, it becomes fard. So if you are that strict, so this keeping a beard becomes fard. There's another group of scholars who say that if the Prophet has commanded and there's nothing contrary, and along with that, if there is a punishment mentioned for that act if you don't do, then it becomes a fard. For example, the Prophet said that keep your trousers above the ankle. If the trousers go below the ankle, then that part will burn in hell. That is a punishment mentioned. So the category which is second category, the staunchest category, even if punishment is not mentioned and nothing contrary is there in any of the Sahih Hadith, it becomes fard. So if you belong to the first category of scholars, keeping a beard becomes fard. The second category of scholars say that if the Prophet has commanded and nothing contrary is mentioned, and if you don't follow that commandment, a punishment is mentioned, it becomes fard. So that is keeping the trousers above the ankle. That's the second group of scholars. Third group of scholars, which are very lax, they say, no, unless it is clearly mentioned haram in the Quran, only if Allah says and Prophet says. That is the third group, which is most lenient. So depending which group of scholars do you follow? Safest is follow the first group, to be the safest. Whatever the Prophet has said, nothing contrary. And try and do as much as possible. But for sure, no one can say that keeping a beard is not mustahab, is not sunnah. It is minimum sunnah, means minimum mustahab. Either fard or mustahab, two options are there. So if you fall in the category of believing those scholars that keeping a beard is fard, then keeping is fard. Even if you believe in those group of scholars, second or third group, even they agree that keeping a beard is sunnah, if they don't say it is fard. But yet, following sunnah is preferable. Now, some people have a different kind of mindset. What they say, if I keep a beard, I'll have to keep it for my full life. Then if I shave it, it's a sin. It's like telling, once I start offering salah, and if I stop offering salah, it's a sin. So I'll not start only offering salah. So many people don't keep a beard. Main beard rakhunga to fir kabhi bhi jindagi mein shave nahi karunga. To abhi tar mazak karne do. 10 saal baad, 15 saal baad rakhenge. So this is absolutely nonsense. Absolutely nonsense according to me. That those people are not keeping it because they say that once I keep shaving is a sin. Some people say after I come back from Hajj, then I start keeping. Why? That means start praying after I come back from Hajj. So this category of people who think that once I start keeping and then if I shave it's a sin. See, keeping is a fard. So even if you keep for 1 year and shave it for 5 days, again keep. Best is never to shave. But that is preferable than not keeping at all. So your question is mainly that if I keep a beard and then if I shave, then it's a sin or not. So if you fall in the category where keeping a beard is a fard, keeping is a fard. If you shave, it becomes a sin, whether if you shave first or second. But if you fall in the category of those who consider that beard is a sunnah, then it's better you at least keep for a few years, even if you shave it for a few days or a few weeks or a few months, yet at least you have done sunnah for that time, for that few years you kept, and again you keep it again. So this is totally illogical to say that once I keep, I should not shave. Or if I shave, it's a sin. If you fall in the category, you believe that keeping a beard is a sunnah, then shaving is not a sin. But I agree with those scholars, at least as far as beard is concerned, that keep it. Even if it's a mustab, it's a very high category of mustab. Sunnahs also have categories. Muqadda, ghayra muqadda. So I consider it to be a very high category. I recommend everyone to keep it. And you should not shave. But if suppose a time comes, you keep it, and then for some reason, if you have to shave also, but that's fard or sunnah, at least start keeping it today. Tomorrow, if that situation arises after 5 years, where you fall in such a trap where you have to shave, best is not to shave, unless your life is in danger, etc., where Islam gives permission. But if something happens, at least you'll get sawab for that few years which you have kept the beard. So this logic that once I keep, if I shave, it will be a sin is totally wrong. If it's a fard, it's a sin not keeping itself now. You can't say, okay, now if I start offering 5 times salah, there may be a situation 5 years later where I may not be able to offer 1 time salah. So then better not start offering 5 times from now. So this logic will be applied everywhere then. And salah is a bigger fard than beard. So it's best that if you know whether fard or mustab, start doing it. When you start, think you'll continue for a lifetime. If God forbid something happens also, yet inshallah you'll get sawab for the time you have kept. Hope that answers the first part of the question.